National Weather Service follows DHS in huge ammo purchase. And this is my article at Infowars.com, also linked on drudgereport.com today. Why would the National Weather Service need to purchase large quantities of powerful ammo? That's the question many are asking after the federal agency followed in the footsteps of the Department of Homeland Security in putting out a solicitation for 46,000 rounds of hollow point bullets. A solicitation which appears on the Fed BizOps website asked for 16,000 rounds of S&W jacketed hollow point bullets, noted for their strengths, to be delivered to locations in Ellsworth, Maine and New Bedford, Massachusetts. A further 6,000 rounds of S&W hollow point bullets will be sent to Wall, New Jersey, with another 24,000 rounds of the same bullets heading to a weather station in St. Petersburg, Florida. And this solicitation, which is on the Fed BizOps website, also asked for 500 paper targets to be delivered to these same locations. So you've got hollow point bullets, which rip apart organs on impact with the human body, and then paper targets. Doesn't quite make sense. But since this story was picked up by the Drudge Report earlier today, no less than the Washington Post waded in and quoted the NOAA, that's the federal organization above the National Weather Service, as claiming that this solicitation for all these thousands of rounds of hollow point bullets was a, quote, clerical error, and that the ammo is not going to the National Weather Service, but instead to the NOAA Fisheries Office of Law Enforcement. So basically, they've come out and said it was an error, it was a mistake, that they never intended to send them to the National Weather Service, but they're going to this other office under the same branch of the federal government. But whoever it's going to, and remember, this is the same government that ships guns to Mexican drug cartels under Fast and Furious, you know, they've proven they can't be trusted. The question remains, why do they need such powerful bullets if they're shooting at paper targets for training drills? Doesn't make sense. Why do you need to buy bullets that are designed to expand on impact with the human body and tear open organs if you're shooting at paper targets? You know, why not just buy cheaper bullets? Well, it's the same question, of course, that's been asked of the Department of Homeland Security. 450 million rounds of hollow point bullets purchased back in March, followed by another 750 million rounds of assorted bullets in a current solicitation that's about to expire in the next few days. So we're talking over a billion rounds of bullets that the DHS has or is about to purchase. And again, they're telling us it's for training and target practice. Why are they buying these massively powerful bullets for shooting at targets? It makes no sense whatsoever. Of course, we know that the DHS is also buying large quantities of riot gear and telling us that civil unrest is right around the corner. But why, amidst all these mass shootings, is the Second Amendment being demonized? You know, we've got legislation introduced by the Democrats to ban the sale of ammo in large quantities online. Why, when that's happening, is the federal government consecutively arming itself to the teeth with ammo and then claiming it's a clerical error when it's being sent to the Weather Service? In fact, it's going somewhere else. And why are they buying, why is the NOAA buying bullets that rip apart internal organs if it's just for target practice? I mean, the DHS has refused to answer questions as to why they're buying these hollow point bullets. Remember, they're actually banned in warfare. They're considered that deadly and dangerous that they're banned under the Geneva Convention in the context of warfare. And another aspect to this, as the denials flood in, is an article out of The Hill, Obama administration, UN arms treaty shouldn't regulate ammunition. So while they're trying to ban it, the large purchase of ammunition online for American citizens, they don't want the UN to do the same thing because, as this article states, the Department of State Conventional Weapons Destruction Program has funded the destruction of over 90,000 tons of excess loosely secured or at-risk ammunition since 2003. So there's another question. The DHS has bought over a billion rounds of ammo. You know, is this merely about trying to keep it out of the hands of the American people, or are they actually planning on using it? And in fact, there was another interesting aspect to this article thrown up by a commenter on the article that was linked on drudgereport.com from Infowars. And he talks about the fact that these bullets are being delivered to an address which shares its location with the National Endowment for Democracy. And if you actually go and look on the solicitation, the NED is listed as the recipient for these bullets under the same banner as the NOAA. So why is the government buying bullets for a non-governmental organization? It's quasi-governmental. Of course, it's a CIA front, but officially it's non-governmental. And then getting all shifty about where these bullets are going. Could it be that the weather service, the fact that they were being sent to the weather service, which was in the original solicitation before they came out today and said, no, that was a clerical error. Could it be a cover for the fact that they're sending ammo to the National Endowment for Democracy, which is one of these regime change shadowy groups run by the CIA? Could these bullets be going to the Syrian rebels that have openly been supported by the National Endowment for Democracy, as the US denies sending any arms to the rebels whatsoever? So we'll continue to have updates on this story as they come in, but very interesting shifting explanations as to where these bullets are going. And the DHS refuses to say anything about why they've purchased over a billion rounds of ammo. And actually, just 10 minutes ago, I got a Facebook message with a link to another solicitation where Social Security is ordering 177,000 rounds of bullets. So the federal government across the board is arming to the teeth while it tells the American people that they should disarm, and as it gears up for riots and civil unrest. Very interesting.
National security correspondent Jennifer Griffin is live at the Pentagon for us now. Jennifer.
Hi, John. Well, a senior U.S. official tells Fox that the president signed what is known in the intelligence community as a finding directing the CIA and other agencies to provide support to the Syrian opposition. The CIA declined to comment. However, the finding, which was signed months ago, we're told, stopped short of allowing the United States government to provide weapons to the Syrian opposition fighters. The U.S. Treasury Department, however, reportedly issued a license last month that would clear the way for private, non-governmental, non-profit groups to provide money to the armed insurgents, which could be used for weapons. This loosening of restrictions that occurred with little fanfare, we're told, last month. Now, the CIA has been helping the Syrian opposition with non-lethal support for some time, helping them with command and control issues, but stopping short of providing weapons at a base in Turkey near Adana. The U.S. has a large air base nearby at Incirlik.
The chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Paul, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, last week I introduced legislation, H.R. 5993, that would prohibit the president from providing military or paramilitary aid of any sort to any faction in the internal fighting in Syria. Unfortunately, it appears that the administration is already very much involved in supporting the overthrow of the Assad government. There's nary a whimper of criticism in Congress over our growing involvement in the civil war in Syria. The only noise we hear from Congress and repeated in the media is the complaint that we're not doing enough and that immediate, direct U.S. military action must be taken. Tragically, our political leaders show both bad judgment and short memories when it comes to the downside of our foreign policy of mischief and intervention. Our compulsion to engage ourselves in every conflict around the world is dangerous to our national security. In dealing with Syria, the administration pretends to pursue diplomacy and provide humanitarian assistance to the people. In reality, the U.S. government facilitates weapons transfers to the rebels who are demanding immediate regime change. My goal is to stop our dangerous participation in the violence in Syria, yet evidence mounts that we're already deeply involved with no expectation that the administration will back away from military engagement. Recent reports indicate that the U.S. is providing logistics and communication assistance to the rebel forces. Assistance in getting arms to the rebels through surrogates is hardly a secret. Cooperating with the rebels' propaganda efforts has been reported and is used to prepare the American people for our coming involvement. There's every reason to expect that the well-laid plans to once again coordinate a favorable regime change will end badly. Even the strongest supporters of our direct and immediate military involvement in Syria admit the rebel forces are made up of many groups, including al-Qaeda, and no one is sure to whom the assistance should be given. All they claim is the need for the immediate removal of Assad. This policy is nothing new, and too often in our recent history, our assistance with dollars and weapons used to overthrow a government ends up with the weapons being used instead against us. The blowback from our policy of intervention has caused a great deal of harm to us since World War II. Propping up the Shah in Iran for 26 years was a powerful factor in motivating radical Islamists to eventually overthrow the Shah in 1979. The hostages taken at the U.S. Embassy at that time was a consequence of our putting the Shah into power in 1953. Working with the Mujahideen in the 1980s, our CIA supported radical Islam in an effort to combat communist occupation in Afghanistan. Later, this led to the radical Islamist hatreds being turned against us over our occupation and interference in Muslim countries. The $40 billion given to Egypt for over 30 years to prop up the Musharraf dictatorship and buy an unstable peace with Israel has ended with what appears to be the takeover of Egypt by the Muslim Brotherhood. They may well turn Egypt into a theocratic Islamic state unless our CIA is able to once again gain control. Al-Qaeda now has a presence in parts of Egypt and has been involved in the bombing of pipelines carrying gas to Israel. This is hardly a policy that is enhancing Israel's security. What are the possible unintended consequences of this policy if we foolishly escalate the civil war in Syria? The worst scenario would be an all-out war in the region involving Russia, the United States, Israel, Iran, Turkey, and others. The escalating conflict could rapidly make containment virtually impossible. Chaos in this region could encourage the Kurds in Syria, Iraq, Turkey, and Iran to decide it's an opportunity to move on their long-sought-after goal of establishing a Kurdish state. Significant hostilities in the region would jeopardize the free flow of oil from the Middle East, causing sharp increases in the price of oil. The already weak economy of the West would suffer immensely. Some will argue erroneously that a major war would be beneficial to the economy and distract from the peoples from their economic woes. War, however, is never an economic benefit, although many have been taught that for many decades. If liberty and prosperity are to be our goals, peace is a necessary ingredient of that process. I yield back.
I don't think the Patriot Act would have been passed if it would have been called Repeal the Fourth Amendment Act.
Is there a time for keeping a distance? The time to turn your eyes away? Is there a time?